Right. So nice to have you all here. And thank you all for joining us for Dr. MACIEJ KARWOSKI's talk. And I just want to introduce him to you all. Dr. KARWOSKI is a professor of psychology and chair of the Creative Behavior Lab at the University of Rocla, the editor-in-chief of the Journal of Creative Behavior, and co-editor of the open access journal Creativity Theories Research Applications. His research interests include the educational psychology of creativity, the role of creative self-beliefs for creative functioning, and new methodological solutions to study creativity. Dr. KARWOSKI is an author and co-author of almost 300 scholarly publications, including the books Creative Self, co-edited with James Kaufman, and the upcoming Creative Agency Unbound, co-authored with Ron Baghetto. So Dr. KARWOSKI today will discuss how students' creative agency drives learning, school functioning, and achievement, with examples of how to strengthen student creative agency to enhance creative thinking and ultimately effective learning. So we are so honored to have you here today. Thank you so much for joining us, and take it away.
Thanks a lot, Desi, and good morning, afternoon, good evening, everyone, doesn't matter where you are. The pleasure is, of course, all mine, and there is a huge honor to be here. I appreciate being invited and having this very, very unique opportunity. That's a great pleasure for me. So what I will be talking about, and what was introduced already, is a construct that popped up several times during this festival, but wasn't particularly deeply discussed so far. So I do hope that you will find it both interesting and somehow useful for all of you who would like to obtain those slides. And there were some questions. Please feel free to make a photo or to scan this QR code. I will show this QR code several times also at the end, so those slides are available, and feel free to contact me also if any of the things I will be discussing will be of your interest, or any questions will arise. And thanking the organizers for inviting me and are organizing this festival, I would also like to say that so far I participated in several sessions and listened to several presentations, and I must say that they were not only very interesting but also quite informative to what I'm going to present and what I'm going to say. So let me first acknowledge several arguments that were already raised by different presenters that I believe are pretty important also for my arguments later on. So, and maybe also advertise some of the talks that perhaps you didn't see, and you will have an opportunity to see the recording. So in the very introductory talk, Anna presented an excellent overview of quite classic works on creativity and learning, with several quite important arguments also for my talk that resonate pretty nicely with what I'm going to show you today, starting with this classic late Dr. Torrance arguments that you need to self-discipline yourself, and the creativity and elements of creative solutions, even if they can or cannot be taught, they require some what we will be calling agentic elements. That's the thing I will define later on. Or this pretty nice Arthur Koestler quote saying that you need to like take two different roles when you create and when you learn, like this self-reference aspect that makes you a teacher and a student at the very same time, all the way to this, I believe, slightly overlooked classic volume edited by Kagan, saying that what we really need, and need much more that we used to analyze, this is focused on some motivational aspects, not only cognitive but motivational as well. I believe so as well, and that's exactly what will be focusing, what this talk will be focusing on. But there were others. Mark Ranko, in an excellent, pretty deep talk, you can see the recording, mentioned Piaget and constructivist along his own theory of personal creativity, and said something which resonates with me pretty strongly, that, you know, that each learning, if this is authentic learning, is creative by definition. If it's not, it probably means it's not really learning, that's memorization rather than. So in a sense, you might argue that those two constructs, this festival is centered around creativity and learning, are in some sense synonymous. I mean that all forms of creativity are in a sense forms of learning, because when you create, you learn something more, not only developed, but also learning requires some kind of creativity for the learner. If it's not, it means it's not learning. James Kaufman yesterday, I couldn't resist to remind you this particular photo, said that there is some evidence, and this is the evidence I will be getting back to, that more creative kids do better, obtain better grades when at school. Of course, this is not the best predictor of school successes, but it is quite strong one. That's once again an argument we will be developing. Today, Paul Solden showed how smart, wise interventions, which are deep, long-term, conducted with schools, translates into higher agency, like higher growth mindsets, but also confidence of both teachers and students, and provided some both qual and quant arguments that it works. And finally, last but not the very least, yesterday Ron Baghetto presenting some arguments about why we shouldn't worry that much about AI, said that human creativity is in fact an agentic action, the claim and the perspective we both share, I believe, kind of creative decision. This is why AI is not a foe, really in that game. It's not intentional, at least so far. So indeed, creativity, human creativity, is a agentic decision, I would add, and so is learning. So what I will be focusing on today is on showing you that learning, the same as creativity, requires agency, and some recent results, or the results we obtain over the last decade, let's say, about creative agency or the role of agency in creativity and creative process, could be, or it is, quite instrumental for learning as well. But before I will move to that, I'd like to also mention some other elements that were, some of them mentioned already, some of them not. So first of all, let us focus on some creative thinking mechanisms or some cognitive or mental processes we believe are important when we are talking about creative thinking or problem solving. And of course, there are plenty of them. Those that are listed here are just a small selection of those that are pretty well researched, and we've got a lot of evidence showing how they work. So remote association, quite classic mechanism, divergent thinking, probably the most often mentioned during this festival, partially because the contribution of Paul Torrens synthesizing insight, mental imagery, and many others. So of course, probably in this group, there is no much need to go into details. Everyone knows what divergent thinking is, that also because of Paul Torrens's contributions, but also Guilford's, that, you know, we are providing our participants, be them students, adults, with some open-ended tasks. We ask them for solutions. We score those solutions for fluency, flexibility, originality, sometimes rarely elaboration. And some of those solutions we can give them, and usually in one of the most popular tasks, we are giving them a typical object, usually a brick, let it be a galosh, and asking them to make something original and useful and appropriate and making sense. And sometimes they are providing ideas of things that are pretty original and quite, you know, quite interesting. They are absolutely relevant. Sometimes they are providing ideas that are not necessarily that interesting, although they might be original. And of course, we know how to score them. Recent developments in automatic scoring make this much easier, well-known mechanism. I will be getting back later. There are others, of course. Creative imagery, that's one of the mechanisms that is not as popular and often analyzed, but still pretty interesting. What you see here are elements of test of creative imagery abilities, test developed by my former doctoral student. By the way, this test is open access, and you can simply download it, and there is a reference at the bottom of this slide. But what we are asking our participants in such a test, which is, by the way, quite similar to in the scope of the divergent thinking, but slightly differently focused, is to select or to choose one of the elements. In fact, they are going through all those elements and to finish them and to develop them and to transform them into something that does not exist, but they believe should, or to provide something interesting. And sometimes people are providing pretty simple drawings with quite a nice interpretation that provides like a fresh look. It could be matches or road or shoes without much detail, but still there is something in it that could be original, even if it's not particularly vivid. Sometimes you observe responses that are much more metaphorical, much more elaborated, much more visually dense, like a happiness bar or a revenge of the elevator operator, someone with garden scissors cutting it down, or giraffe by Salvador Dali, Siamese giraffe. So we've got quite a lot of different well-identified mechanisms, quite developed measurement, which seems to be valid and reliable, quite predictive, what we know also from works of E. Paul Torrens. But what is quite interesting and quite a strong point, I would say, is that all of those and many others are quite ordinary processes. What does it mean, ordinary? First of all, they're not particularly specific to creative thinking. We are using our divergent thinking, we are using our imagination, we are using our remote association, and so on and so forth, not only when we are dealing with creative tasks. We are using them all the time in our family situations, in thinking about our future, not only when we create. What is particularly interesting and particularly important, we are also using them when we learn, something new. Those are mental and cognitive processes that are pretty interesting and pretty important in several different situations. That's important point. John Baer yesterday said there is not such a thing as creativity. So I could be equally radical by saying there are not particularly creative abilities or skills in that sense, that they are not specific to creativity and there is nothing particularly creative in them. They matter for creativity, but they also matter for very broad range of different human activities, be them cognitive and not only, including learning, which brings those two concepts together. And I will say more about that in a second. Let us move to other quite relevant thing, I think, for this festival. I brainstormed a little bit about some strategies or what we have learned about those different processes over those decades. Can we formulate some take-home messages or some advices which are well-established and some kind of evidence-based? And it seems it occurs we can. Like, we can quite safely say that seems legitimate, that seems reasonable, that we should not stop with our first ideas, that our first ideas should serve as a kind of a base. We should develop, modify them, give ourselves time to explore. Why? Because we know from the so-called serial order effect that our ideas' originality grow with time, even if we feel the opposite. We are quite often inaccurate in our expectations while originality grows. Or we can say, if you feel tired, let it go for a while, or go for a walk that really works, go jogging, go to the gym, take a shower. So once again, this incubation period, this resting time, allows our brain and our mind to reestablish different connections and to forget what didn't work. Quite a well set advice, I would say. Or don't leave complex problems to the last minute. Don't procrastinate. Don't generate on the fly. Don't leave it because the stress, but also the fact that you can't incubate, won't work want to make it successful, or try to monitor your thinking. With each new idea, try to analyze if this idea fulfills your goals. Is it original enough? That's difficult, that's challenging, that's demanding mentally, but its inhibition process makes your ideas usually better. Once again, we've got solid evidence for them. Some more. Think relationally, think in terms of analogies, try to see the forest rather than the trees, connect different problems, different tasks. Does it work? Yeah, it works. We see a lot of examples in creativity literature that shows it works. Or that one is a little bit postmodern, I see. Deconstruct to reconstruct. So divide to then connect. Decompose the problem into sub-problems, smaller problems, and try to find new combinations or new perspective. This is how insight usually is born. Be attentive and mindful. This is something that was discussed during the last session. Yeah? Paid attention, but also in that sense that try to pay attention, for instance, to the images that occur in your head just before you get asleep. What is happening? How you transform those images? So don't be afraid to close your eyes, to imagine something, to see that sometimes you need to cut off information from the background to give your visual cortex place to work. Put down your smartphone and pay attention to what is going on. So probably we can like list quite easily much more. So it seems we've got quite solid evidence that there are some heuristics, there are some advices, there are some evidence-based arguments that seem to support generating and elaborating ideas, that seem to support divergent thinking. But my argument here would be all of those advices, all of those, let's call them strategies, they are pretty solid, but they are absolutely not specific to creativity. As once again, they would work also when you are talking about learning how to organize the material you are going to learn. They are also quite effective in solving problems that are not necessarily creative problems, regular, ordinary problems. So once again, also those strategies could be quite applicable. And my argument would be they are pretty applicable to learning, which brings me to one of the arguments, kind of initial argument for that moment, that to paraphrase our fellow field member and a great creativity scholar, Paul Sylvia, The argument would be that creativity and learning are pretty similar after all. Paul published like 8 years ago, if I see correctly, a paper or almost a decade ago that intelligence and creativity are pretty similar. Yes, creativity and learning share a lot of important similarities. Let you take a look at this girl. She was presented at my initial slide. Does she learn? Or does she create? Or perhaps both? How can we know? What about now? Well, small detail and small change, and probably many people would be eager to say, well, she creates just because of the colors, yeah, just because of the implicit theory and association with the arts. Well, there are several arguments why we should consider them similar. The first, already mentioned during this festival, is the knowledge base. Both learning and creativity require knowledge, both declarative, procedural, semantic, episodic, etc. Of course, during the process of learning and during the process of creativity, new knowledge is created as well. But without knowledge, it's simply not effective. There are some intellectual factors, we quite often call them potential, that are predictive to both learning and creativity. And sometimes those are the same factors. Let it be intelligence. Intelligence, of course, matters much more to learning than to creativity, but it matters for creativity as well. Divergent thinking, I will show you some arguments that although it predicts creative achievement to a bigger extent, it also predicts school functioning. Some more stable with more personality traits. Jeb Puryear is here. Jeb did an excellent meta-analysis showing how big five personality traits, mainly I would call them hungry mind personality traits, like openness, like extroversion, how they are predictive to creativity. James Kaufman yesterday said that conscientiousness is much more predictive to learning than to creativity. In creativity, it is much more complex. But indeed, certain stable characteristics are important because they like motivate us to work in certain direction, to conduct some problems or to skip the others. More malleable, we call them usually surface personality traits, which are related to self-perception, to our creative or academic self-concept. They are more changeable. They are pretty important to whether we will engage into both learning or creativity or not. I will move to them in a sec. And emotions, cognitive, metacognitive strategies, all those factors that are much more dynamic, much more processual, which translate into effectiveness or lack of effectiveness of the actions we are taking and work in such a reciprocal relationships, they matter for both as well. They matter for creativity, they matter for learning. So those underpinnings, those psychological characteristics that stand behind creativity and learning, they are pretty similar. I'm not an expert, but you might also argue that you know some brain mechanisms, like the functioning of executive mode network works for that, for both, is important for both. While of course certain categories like default both brain network is more important for creativity. So to summarize the evidence about the links between creativity and school achievement, it was like 8 years ago, together with Ronald Baghetto and my former doctoral student, Ola Gaida, who was, by the way, the lead author, we published a large meta-analysis in Journal of Educational Psychology on worldwide on 50,000 participants, more than 100 independent studies, showing that the correlation between creativity, mainly operationalized and measured as divergent thinking, and different measures of school achievement, sometimes grades, sometimes standardized achievement tests, is positive. And according to today's standard, we would call it moderate rather than weak. So 0.22 is not particularly strong, but it is positive. So it shows that on average, there is a clear tendency showing that indeed, as James yesterday said, more creative students tend to be better students and vice versa. Better students are usually more creative. It does not mean by any means that there are no exceptions. Of course there are. But this effect holds even when we control for some cognitive factors like intelligence, some personality factors like openness. So it works. 2 years later, we conducted a large study which was longitudinal, by the way. This one was specific because it was done on Polish middle schoolers, so might be specific to Poland. When we focused on more contextualized, more specific, subject-specific relationship between creativity and school achievement and learning in language and math, we created like a peculiar kind of a test that was quite specific. We called them CLISAT, Creative Learning in School Achievement Test. And with this particular test that is much better contextualized, we almost doubled these relationships. It's almost 0.40, so much stronger. It is not strong, but it's robust enough to say that indeed, it's quite a relationship, you would say. But what was published pretty recently, like a month or 2 months ago, a paper I strongly recommend to everyone who is here, a paper authored by a group of authors. One of them is by the way, associated with University of Georgia, Denis Dimach, who will be presenting just after this session. This is a paper introducing MOTES, so Measuring Original Thinking in Elementary School, pretty creative test for elementary school students, fully automated. And what the authors demonstrated was that the results in MOTES, the results of kids, were correlated with school achievement test up to 0.33. So this is pretty strong correlation. And everyone, or almost everyone, is waiting what PISA 2022 will release in fact the next month. Of course, PISA goals are slightly different. They will be focusing rather on differences in those more static and more creative skills across and between countries. But of course, the question is what the correlation will be. I won't show it to you because I don't know them. But if I would have to finish right now this presentation, I would say that from all the studies, this take-home message is an extremely important one and quite overlooked. And this message is creativity is not a foe for learning, it's a friend. And you know that there is a clear evidence from many different labs across the world showing that creative thinking and higher level of those processes we usually associate with creative thinking is positively correlated with the effectiveness of learning. It does not mean that we shouldn't improve schools. Of course we should, but so far it's not that bad. Even more, when we look at the longitudinal relationships, there are not so many such studies. This is one of the studies we've done of quite a large sample, 1200 middle school students with 6 months apart measurement. What we observed, we measured school achievement twice and creativity in that particular case in math twice. And what we found is cross-locked links, meaning that we observe pretty clear effects showing that school achievement at the beginning of our measurement translated into the improvement of creativity after a semester, and higher creativity at the beginning of our study translated even more strongly into improvement in school achievement. And for us, improvement of school achievement means learning. You can't improve them without learning, despite what we think about tests, et cetera. So there is also quite convincing argument that is more dynamic. I will stop this part of the story in a second, and we'll move into the most interesting from my perspective point, which is this agency elements. Because a few years back, just to give you an overview, together with my colleagues, some of them from my lab, the others that not, like Ron Baghetto, we realize what seems quite obvious, of course, for anyone who studies creativity, that generally speaking, creative potential results in tests, for example, divergent thinking, serves as a quite moderate predictor of achievement. We've got great studies from Paul Torrens sample, but there are not that many. There are some arguments to consider potential as a kind of necessary yet not sufficient condition of achievement. So it helps, but it guarantees nothing. Where if the potential is pretty low, it's much harder, almost impossible to achieve much. So this is more like complex relationship. And that makes perfect sense when we think that potential is something we our skills, our abilities, but more abilities than skills, and that real achievement, behavior and activity requires a lot, that it requires support, it requires time and training and special skills that are domain specific, the decision to act, luck. And that brings us to this very concept of creative agency we started to explore. I should probably define it on my own, but yesterday Ron provided a definition we are currently working on. So for consistency, let me cite it. It was exactly what he presented. We understand in the work we are right now conducting creative agency as the intentional, which is critical. The intention, the purpose is critical, and self-directed capacity to, and once again, envision and enact new and meaningful actions within the existing constraints of a particular context, which can bring about changes in our life and the world around us. What is important is this envision and enact. Envisioning alone is not sufficient to make the change. You need to enact. And to enact, some things are required, and I will be focusing on them right now. We started 5 or something years ago with a model we called CBAA, which is an acronym for creative behavior as agentic action. So when we thought about this relationship between potential and behavior all the way to achievement, based on different theories, mainly within so-called social cognitive theorizing, we realized that there are some arguments to think about at least two elements as potential intervening factors. One is confidence. There were other labels used previously. Let's stay with confidence. So the feeling you can. And this feeling you can, this confidence, be it creative confidence in this particular case, but it could be school confidence, math confidence, is developed under the influence of several arguments. One of them is your potential. One of them is your abilities. Why? Because of your previous successes, thanks to those abilities, because of the feedback you are receiving, and many things like this. So we predicted and expected that potential somehow influences and shapes confidence, which then translates into behavior. The other one was value, was centrality, was kind of the importance of creativity to your identity. We theorize that if you don't care about your creativity, or if you don't care about your school, your potential, your abilities don't really matter, because you see no argument to engage. So in a sense, this centrality is a kind of decisive factor in that sense that if it's low, the chances to translate potential into behavior are much lower, close to zero, actually. And yesterday, Ron presented this more elaborated model we are developing right now, introducing two additional elements. One, on top of confidence and value or centrality, is risk-taking. So the question, will I do this creatively if I care and I believe I can? And the other, which we are developing quite intensively or working on right now, I will say a few words more in a sec, is self-regulation. So whether I know how to make it. And what have we learned so far from different studies conducted in this area? Some of them are summarized in those works that are cited, but below, some of them are under review right now. So let me start with quite an obvious, no-brainer kind of observation. I believe that in this group, there are no doubts that creative abilities can be developed. We've got quite convincing evidence that creativity training works. By the way, a week ago, there was a new paper published in Psychological Bulletin showing that very likely those effects are lower than we expected and believed because of some kind of effects of publication bias, but they are still positive. So we've got arguments to believe that due to training, due to smart and wise programs in our schools, due to good schooling, we can improve creative abilities. That works. That's nothing particularly new. That's old news. But also importantly, what we see is that this development of creative abilities also improves creative agency. And the question is how and why? Is it kind of byproduct, or is it something more substantial here? Well, we see in our studies, those are results we conducted with Eva Wisniewska on a huge training effect, but we replicated that in a lab in experimental settings, that this improvement in agency is largely, we are observing, is largely due to the improvement in creative thinking. So to make it clearer, like change brings change. So this is a kind of an effect we are calling abilities shape confidence. When people observe their abilities grow, they start to believe that they can, which is quite obvious and pretty consistent with what Albert Bandura proposed like decades ago. And it's pretty consistent with our CBAA model. So that's one thing. Another thing we are observing in several research is that activating creative agency makes people think, but also act more creatively. And this is an effect we replicated several times in various experiments, but also we obtain it in so-called wise interventions. So dynamic studies when on a daily basis, we gave students different prompts, they're engaged into different activities to boost their creative agency. And we saw that after such boosting, they declared, but also engaged into various creative activities across different domains. So we can boost agency, and that translates into higher creativity. So why? One mechanism we are testing is that because it improves self-regulation. So people who believe in their skills, who are more confident, they posit like bolder goals, they monitor better, then use smarter strategies. But importantly, it also works the other way around. This is a series of studies that is primarily had, and the main author is Olajinska, showing that when we teach self-regulation, when we improve, boost self-regulation, that also translates into higher agency people have. Why? Once again, because they feel that they can do this, because they know how. So this feeling how translates into feeling that I am. And getting back to this longitudinal study I mentioned before, we observed those cross-lagged links, so that school achievement improved creativity improved school achievement. We see in our studies that the creative confidence tends to mediate this effect. So people who are more creative, but also people who achieve a lot, they start to believe they can change this domain, they can contribute creatively into this domain, and that translates into both the higher school achievement and higher creativity. We see this across several studies. But what is probably even more important, we do see that in several studies, including longitudinal studies, when we measure people's creativity, people's creative agency, but also the learning effects, the school achievement across various samples and in different studies, we see that first of all, creative confidence. But creative confidence in particular academic domains, so feeling that I can contribute to math or to language, to provide something that is unique, original, meaningful, it correlates quite moderately with academic self-concept, well-established predictor and important construct in educational psychology. So this is not the same. They're correlated, but they are unique. Second, even more importantly, creative confidence predicts school achievement over and beyond academic self-concept, which means it is incrementally valid, which means it adds something. This is not just an epiphenomenon of believing that I'm a good student. This is something more. Feeling creative helps learning. And third, and probably the most importantly, in longitudinal studies, it predicts school achievement in a certain domain. In our case, we tested it in math, we tested it in language, after a semester, so in a longitudinal design, when controlling for academic self-concept and importantly, initial achievement, which means it translates into growth of achievement, which means it translates into learning, because that's the growth of achievement, what growth of achievement is, which I believe, once again, consistently with this correlational evidence I presented before, that's an important take-home message for, you know, policymakers, for teachers, for ourselves, that there is not conflict between the two. They contribute to each other's development. And to slightly change a subject a little bit, but not really, as you will see, the question arises, how can we support confidence? How can we support learning? How can we support creativity? We know a lot. What you can see here are the older and newer edition, the sequel of Visible Learning, a kind of a Bible for educational psychologists. So John Hattie's book showing how what works in short in education, what translates into school achievement. And one of the most effective, if not the most effective and positive instruments, very powerful, teachers have is feedback. Is feedback, so information provided by an agent, usually teacher, could be peer, could be parent, regarding aspects of one's performance and understanding. The effect size of feedback's influence is extremely high. It's like 0.75, if I remember correctly. So feedback works pretty well when it comes to explaining school achievement and the learning process, and it makes perfect sense. Which brings us to the question, what is the role of feedback for creativity? And that's something that seems slightly beyond the scope of this talk, but it is related, as you will see. So I'd like to spend this live 5-7 minutes discussing the very unique project we started with our colleagues, like a year ago almost. And this project was conducted together with Copernicus Science Center, which is a huge science museum located in Warsaw, Poland, the capital of Poland. Extremely popular with about 1 million visitors every year. If you will have any opportunity to visit it, strongly recommend it. In this Copernicus Center, together with Copernicus staff, we created an exhibit. So one of the many exhibits that are here that invites our participants to train and to unleash actually the creativity. This exhibit is quite specific because it uses artificial intelligence as a friend and co-worker and feedback giver, an agent, but not necessarily the one that creates, the one that helps. What we used was a new system called ODRA, so which stands for Automated Drawing Assessment Platform, developed by Roger Beatty and his colleagues. And in fact, Roger and J.D. Patterson participated pretty closely in developing this exhibit. ODRA was trained on a large number of drawings people created, and those drawings were scored for creativity by judges and human judges. And ODRA was trained to that extent that, in fact, the correlation between ODRA scores and human judges is like 0.80, which means, according to our standards, it's amazing. It's quite often we see lower correlations between human judges than between human judges and ODRA, which means that AI is able to provide an immediate feedback regarding the originality, at least, in fact, creativity as well, of different drawings created. Let me show you how it works. There is a short movie showing how I'm dealing with this exhibit. So after providing some basic demographic information like age, sex, and condition, whether I'm alone or with people, there is info about the exhibit and a kind of warm-up. When you select the object and you are asked to finish it to create something that is original and, you know, somehow creative. And this is just a warm-up. So I'm created something like, which seems like a bird. When it finished, you can provide it a title, you can give a title, but that's optional. And you are asked to assess what you think, how original is this drawing. So I'm providing a kind of a score, and then the real part starts. So you are first you are provided with an unfinished object, which is here on the left side. And before you start, you're asked a question about your confidence, actually. So to what extent you believe you can provide something that will be scored as original, then you draw. So I'm drawing. That won't be particularly creative, forgive me. Creativity folks are not always the most creative guys. So that's something done especially for the sake of this movie. But the process of creation begins. It's almost done. A little bit more elaboration here. By the way, ODRA is not easy to fool. You can't fool it just by providing more details, more elaboration. I provided a title, and then after finishing, I'm scoring, I'm self-evaluating myself again after the task is done. And it asks me, try again. I will explain in a second why. So there is no direct immediate feedback provided by AI, at least not in this condition. It will be provided when I will finish the second drawing, which I'm doing right now, or our participants are doing. Yeah, it's almost done. As you can see, it took me like 2 minutes to create those two drawings. It is titled, and once again, I'm providing a score. And right now I'm receiving, there is a problem with light here, but I'm receiving AI scores this one is in Polish, for both of my drawings. And this, so this assessment is delayed. It is provided after the second drawing. So in a sense, it works in that way that you are creating a drawing. That's my daughter creating it. When the drawing is done, you can add it a title, and you assess creativity of this drawing, and you are providing, or you are provided or you are not provided, depending on the condition, with immediate feedback of the AI that shows how creative your drawing was or not. As was presented in this movie, this clip you just saw, it can be also delayed feedback. What is quite important is that this feedback touches upon two things. First thing is how creative your drawing, how original actually your drawing was. The other thing is your alignment of your assessment with AI assessment. So it tells you whether you underestimated or overestimated yourself, or perhaps you were absolutely accurate and you knew it, how original it was. And those are examples of those drawings. Of course, there are plenty of them. Some of them are great. But what is quite important is that over 10 months, from July last year until the end of April, we collected data from almost 30,000 participants and on more than 70,000 drawings. Actually, it is more right now. This is not the current numbers, which probably makes it the largest naturalistic kind of experiment in creativity field everywhere. And what I'm going to show you, which I believe is pretty related to our discussion today, are kind of an answer to three big questions. Of course, there are more to come, but those three are the main ones. So first one is, does this AI generated feedback, which is provided on the fly on Earth, improve those drawings' creativity / originality? So importantly, can we learn from it? Can we improve? Does it work, such a feedback? Second, are people, or are we becoming more metacognitively accurate thanks to such feedback? And with time also, can we learn from time? So can we teach metacognition this way? Can we teach people how to recognize what is not that creative and that original? And finally, how does creative confidence, so those prior assessments, influence effort people put into those drawings, and both their post-task self-evaluation and this assessment AI provides? Does it work? What we see, it's quite convincing. So first of all, people learn from AI provided feedback. They become more creative. When they start, the first drawing, but the differences between experimental groups, so this group that will receive feedback just after this drawing, but did not receive it yet, and control group, they are non-existent. Those scores are absolutely the same. But the second drawing, when the first group already received feedback, in the second drawing, the originality clearly improves while it declines in the control group. When we move to the third drawing, it is stable in experimental group, but tends to improve in the control group. What happens? The answer is pretty simple. Here, we've got feedback in experimental group. Here, feedback is also provided in the control group. So control switches to experimental in a sense. We are providing feedback. People learn quite immediately, even if AI provides this feedback. Another thing, people are becoming more metacognitively aware thanks to the feedback. The alignment between their self-assessment and AI self-assessment grows, increases. When we start with the first drawing, the correlation between their self-assessment and how AI assesses them is 0.13. And it's exactly the same in both conditions. And what is pretty funny is that 0.13 is exactly the estimate obtained in the latest meta-analysis on this topic published in the JCB. This is up to the third decimal the same. What happens in the second drawing? This correlation clearly improves in experimental groups. So they are better aware, they are more aware what counts as original. They are not only improving their originality, also in their awareness of originality. The third group, the third drawing, the same thing happens. Once again, here we've got feedback in experimental. Here we've got feedback also in control. Control is not longer is no longer controlled. So it seems we can teach people how to recognize what counts as original or creative or not. We can teach them, they can learn in such a feedback-related condition. And finally, this creative confidence issue. Creative confidence, so their self-evaluation translate quite nicely into the drawing creativity. We see significant, relatively robust effect. But what is pretty interesting, or even much interesting, is some mediational, some mechanisms, some processual things we observe. So first thing is those who are more creatively confident, those who self-evaluate themselves higher before, so those who believe they will be able to make it, they spend much more time on task. Their engagement is higher. You might say that's obvious. That's something to expect. I agree, that was my hypothesis, but that's not that obvious at all. Many people would say, and many research, by the way, shows that people who are high in creative confidence, they sometimes do not engage that much because they feel this is easy. There is no need to engage that much. So here we see that confidence really motivates people. It makes the engagement higher. Moreover, their engagement translates into this post-task confidence. So this awareness, this metacognitive accuracy, by the way, the correlation between this pre-task confidence and this post-task confidence, it is significant, it is robust, but it's not like curved in stone. It's not one. It means that they change their perception, they learn. Finally, this post-task confidence translates into creativity. All in all, those effects that are marked red show that, first of all, this creative confidence matters for drawing creativity, that people who are more confident are more engaged, exactly as expected in CBAA model. They spend more time, they are more engaged in making those drawings. Higher engagement translates into higher creativity, the same as this post-task confidence. And in this experimental group, as we demonstrated, we can show it. So all in all, this is naturalistic. This is messy in terms of surroundings. This is not a kind of a lab study we are doing. That's done on the fly, but it shows that we can teach or we can learn from feedback provided quite naturalistically. So I expected that this dense number of different things I'd like to cover today will not allow me for a kind of discussion and summary. So that's why I tried to summarize those different points. So given that, I'm really looking forward to see your comments and to answer at least some of your questions. Let me just thank you for your attention and once again for the invitation. The QR code is here again, so please feel free to download those slides. And of course, if I won't be able to answer all questions, if there are any, feel free to drop me a line and I'm happy to answer by email. Thank you very much and looking forward to any questions you might have.
Thank you so much. That was incredible. And I captivated the entire time. So feel free to post questions, all of you, in the chat window. I'm going to be going through this. And we do have one from Dr. Ruth Richards, who says, then what meaning do we seek and larger purpose, right, with centrality to include? Agree? Are we able to extend our empathy broadly? Are ethical aspects of creativity related? And in parentheses, hope you're adding that. See Moran et al. Edited 2014 Ethics of Creativity. What is driving us and why? Gray area, especially today.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. I'd say, Dr. Richards, that's always great to see such thought-provoking questions. I'd say I consider that more of a comment than question. A comment. I fully agree. I must say that first of all, agency construct is a kind of a positive. It's a positive construct in that sense that we perceive creativity and the basis is a perception of creativity as something that is good, that is valuable, it's ethically correct. So new works about, you know, malevolent creativity, etc. Yeah, this model doesn't touch them really. So this centrality of creativity, really feeling that I can be creative means I can contribute, meaning contribute to for the sake of goodness, of development. I'm aware of those Ranamoran works in ethics, and I think that definitely fits well into this scope. Thank you very much for this comment.
Thank you so much. And we have a question from Yujun Kim. Your presentation really inspired me. I strongly believe creative agency is a meaningful construct we must look at closely. I would like to know how creative centrality is different from creative personal identity.
Excellent question, actually. And I'd say it's broader. Slightly broader. And recently, especially having this opportunity to work with Dr. Baguette on a book that we hope will be published soon on creative agency, we tried to provide some order into various categories and labels that were used previously. And it also relates to categories as creative self-efficacy, creative self-concept. We previously discussed why those are not exactly the same, or there is sometimes some jingle jangle issues that different labels are used, but the measurement is not necessarily that accurate. So we believe that this confidence category is simply better, and it could cover both more dynamic creative self-efficacy and more static creative self-concept. And the very same applies to creative personal identity. So I'm not against saying that you could treat them as synonyms. So creative personal identity in this classic understanding and classic sense means that it's something that occupies a central place in your identity. However, there were also other constructs like creative role identity, feeling as a creative teacher or feeling as a creative employee, which is more related to workplace. And once again, we thought that having this more overarching construct of centrality covers them both. So in a sense, there is nothing wrong with creative personal identity. Centrality is just broader because it applies not only to your like personal identity, but also your work or your work role identity. That was the reason to go beyond it and to use more consistent labels and categories. Thank you.
Dr. Abraham, if you want to chime in, that'd be wonderful.
Oh gosh, we have just a minute or two left. Thank you, Maciej. That was just such a gorgeous presentation, and I really appreciate the shout outs to so many people in the field, in this festival and outside. Very few people are that generous with their attention, so I really, that's amazing. I'd like to take a bit of a devil's advocate approach. First of all, I was thinking, okay, is confidence the same as agency? All of these terms are somehow used so interchangeably. Perhaps a little more clarity is necessary then, and probably you get into that in your book. But the thing I was thinking about is, you know, there seems to be an arms race to use AI for creativity assessments and so on. And I'm concerned on the other side of the lack of, the reflection that I see, and perhaps you would be the one to write this piece to say, what does this mean for how we assess creativity? It's interesting that an AI system that doesn't really understand what it's seeing is able to influence creative confidence. And that people's confidence in their abilities can change from another agent. And there's a lot of this. The Gianna Roos talk yesterday was really interesting as well about, you know, we see AI as an intentional creature. It doesn't really matter if it isn't or is. So I'm wondering how that sort of fits, philosophically speaking, with agency at all, because you can influence a person's sense of agency about what they do creatively, based on a system that doesn't understand it. I feel like it may introduce another level of, well, what can sap or take away from your own sort of endogenous feeling of what is that from where all this confidence and agency sort of emerges. And we're out of time, but if you want to say something briefly, and then we close the session.
Yeah, I would definitely be switching to Danny's session as well. So just a 10 second comments. First of all, fully agree. I mean, you might say it, pragmatically speaking, AI does not need to understand what it's scoring as long as it the correlation is almost one. But of course, it's not convincing. But our approach and our perspective always was that AI is not an agent in terms of being able to intentionally create. It could be a tool. But you raised an extremely valid point. I need to think about it. Thank you very much for that. That's exactly the point that it influences indeed what people think about themselves, and we must take care about it. That's the point. Thank you,
Maciej.
Thank you very much. Oh, thank you everyone for having me.
Yep, thank you all, and we'll switch over to Dennis right now. You were wonderful, and we'll close out this session. Thank you again.
Thank you.